Let's go back in time to see what really did happen. Too far. Let's go back to the first century in the year of our Lord. Jesus Christ is said to have lived this life here in the first three decades of the century, dying somewhere around the year 33. The Gospels all came later. Mark was the first one written, and the other three are clearly derived from Mark. Mark mentions the destruction of the Jewish temple, which happened in the year 70. So the Gospels all came later than that, probably much later. There's a gap of four decades or more. Most of what we know about this period comes from a man who says he saw Jesus Christ come to him in a vision. He was the Apostle Paul, formerly known as Saul of Tarsus.
After many days of hard traveling, Saul's caravan was near its destination, Damascus. The journey was nearly over. Then suddenly,
he is ill.
The light, the light.
Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?
Who art thou, Lord?
Paul says the Lord told him to start spreading the word of Jesus Christ, and he did it with a vengeance.
Your heart is not right before God. Repent, therefore, of this wickedness of yours, for I see that you are in the bond of iniquity.
Paul was a bit of a scold, but the salvation he offered through the God he called Christ Jesus was very popular. He traveled widely and in his wake left behind groups of new Christians who formed the early Christian church. Paul wrote lots of letters about Christianity. In fact, he wrote 80,000 words about the Christian religion. These documents represent almost all we have of the history of Christianity during this decades-long gap. And here's the interesting thing. If Jesus was a human who had recently lived, nobody told Paul. Paul never heard of Mary, Joseph, Bethlehem, Herod, John the Baptist. He never heard about any of these miracles. He never quotes anything that Jesus is supposed to have said. He never mentions Jesus having a ministry of any kind at all. He doesn't know about any entrance into Jerusalem. He never mentions Pontius Pilate or a Jewish mob or any trials at all. Paul doesn't know any of what we would call the story of Jesus, except for these last three events. And even these, Paul never places on earth. Just like the other savior gods of the time, Paul's Christ Jesus died, rose, and ascended all in a mythical realm. Paul doesn't believe that Jesus was ever a human being. He's not even aware of the idea. And he's the link between the time frame given for the life of Jesus and the appearance of the first gospel account of that life. This is why you don't hear many Christian leaders talking about the early days of Christianity. Because once you assemble the facts, the story is that Jesus lived, everyone forgot. And then they remember. This is just a simulation. But it gets even shakier than that. Allegorical literature was extremely common back then. This is just a simulation.
This is just a simulation. Mark himself probably did not believe he was writing history. He was writing a symbolic message. He was writing a gospel, you know, the good news, and symbolizing it using, biblical parallels, using parallels to pagan religions and so forth.
There are these other Gospels, and there are the Apocrypha, after all. There are apocryphal New Testament and apocryphal Old Testament stories that were, frankly, were too folkloristic, and they got thrown out because people thought these couldn't have happened, therefore we get rid of them. But, of course, some of the apocryphal stories are as interesting as the regular Bible.
So they kept in walking on water and rising from the dead.
They kept
but the others, those were not too outlandish.
Well, there have been attempts to so-called, it's called demythologizing. There have been attempts mostly by Jesuits and other intellectuals who say, who are upset by the, in a sense, the folklore, if you like. And they say, let's make this more intellectual. Let's get rid of the folklore. Let's get rid of the virgin birth, which it seems unlikely. Let's get rid of all this stuff. But of course, if you take away the folklore away from the Bible, you don't have a heck of a lot left except begat.
Well, in the case of someone like Caesar Augustus, around whom many of the same myths clustered, we know there nonetheless was a Caesar Augustus because he's intricately tied into the history of the time, and many secular historians talk about it. You can't rewrite history without Caesar Augustus. But at the very two points, Jesus appears to be locked into history. These stories are either still mythical, like the slaughter of the innocents derived right out of the book of Exodus, or they contain outrageous improbabilities, such as the Jewish Supreme Council meeting on Passover Eve to get rid of this guy. It's just out of the question. Or Pontius Pilate letting go a known killer of Romans, an insurrectionist, Barabbas, and just letting Jesus be thrown to the mob after, however, trying to get him off the hook as if he has to have a vote on it. It just defies any kind of historical verisimilitude. And then when you realize, well, you know, there were other ancient Jews and Jewish Christians that believed Jesus had been killed a century before under King Alexander Janias. Or in the Gospel of Peter, it says that Herod had Jesus killed. Well, how could this be a matter of such diversity if it was a recent event that people remembered? It just begins to make you wonder, is this man really part of a historical time stream? Or doesn't it begin to look like someone has tried to put a figure originally mythical into a historical framework and made various stabs at it?
Can you give me an example of a story that started as fiction, as known to have been fiction, and then it became considered real with the addition of details?
Oh, well, we've seen this any number of times in, say, our Blurge stories, where stories have started out as actual works of fiction, where they were written by identifiable authors. They were written and provided as works of fiction. And they have since gained a life and a spread on their own, where they are now told and relayed as true stories, as this really happened tales, and are believed as such.
You ever read that news story about the guy who was found dead, and they couldn't figure out how he died? But when they did the autopsy, they found out he had a can of Spam shoved down his throat. Turns out he was a spammer, and that's why he got killed. People like the moral of that story, which is why I made it up. And when I first posted it on my weblog, I labeled it as fiction.
Jesus' life does conform to the hero pattern. It's a hero pattern with so many incidents. Raglan gave a score. He took actually the Oedipus story of all things as the basic model, and then gave other heroes scores as to how many of the 22 points they had in their lives. Because it's Raglan's pattern that is the one that I used. His mother is, here's the hero of tradition from Raglan's The Hero. I'm getting this from The Study of Folklore, an early book that I edited. His mother is a royal virgin. His father is a king, often a near relative of his mother. But four, the circumstances of his conception are unusual. Five, he's also reputed to be the son of a god. Six, at birth an attempt is made often by his father to kill him. But seven, he's spirited away. And eight, reared by foster parents in a far country. Nine, we're told nothing of his childhood, but ten, on reaching manhood, he returns or goes to his future kingdom. And 11, after a victory over a king or a giant or a dragon, he marries a princess. 12, 13, becomes king. 14, reigns uneventfully, but 15, prescribes laws. 16, later, he loses favor with his subjects. 17, is driven from the throne of the city. 18, he meets with a mysterious death. 19, often at the top of a hill. 20, his children, if any, do not succeed him. 21, his body is not buried, but nevertheless, 22, he has one or more holy sepulchres. So, Oedipus gets 22 points out of the 22. Theseus gets 20, Romulus 17, Hercules 17, Perseus 16, etc. I don't remember off the top how many Jesus got, but it was high. You are just an illustration.
There are other similar savior figures in the same neighborhood at the same time in history. Mithras, Attis, Adonis, Osiris, Tammuz, and so forth. And nobody thinks that these characters are anything but mythical, and their stories are so similar, most of them in fact having some kind of resurrection or another, sometimes even with celebrations after 3 days and so forth, that it just seems like special pleading to say, oh, well, in this one case, it really happened. Church fathers understood this as a problem because they were already getting the same objections from pagans. They said, what you say about Jesus, we've been saying about the, you know, Dionysus and Hercules all the time, what's the big deal? And they didn't believe in them either anymore. And so the Christian apologists, the defenders of the faith, would say, well, yeah, but this one is true. And you see, Satan counterfeited it in advance because he knew this day would come. Boy, I tell you, that tells you two things right there, that even they didn't deny that these other Jesus-like characters were before Jesus, or they never would have resorted to something like that. Satan knew it would happen and counterfeited it in advance.
In case you're wondering, yes, this remains the explanation to this day. Fortunately for Christian leaders, they almost never have to offer it.